Well, let me just start off by welcoming those of you that are here first time. I know there's a lot of family, friends, coworkers, and the like. We're so grateful to have you in the house, and we'd love to get to know you, love to hear your story, and if you're wondering what's happening around here at Lighthouse Church, it is a bunch of broken people that met the most incredible Savior, had our lives radically, radically transformed. And so we are grateful to have you. I also want to welcome those of us that are watching online, those that are sitting in the chapel. Can we show them some room love? Come on, somebody. This is undoubtedly one of the greatest highlights of Lighthouse Church, to watch what we will see in just a few moments of men and women, young and old, all shapes and sizes, backgrounds and stories, be baptized into this watery grave, raised to new life in Jesus, testifying before our whole family what Jesus has done. And I've been looking forward to it. I wouldn't miss it. I would have you know that I got on a plane at 5 a.m. this morning. I was at a funeral from a dear friend, mentor, pastor that I love so much, but my wife and I would not have missed this, and so we caught I don't even think that's the early bird. That's a weird bird. I don't even understand that. But we're here for it, and I couldn't be more excited. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna pray, I'm gonna share with you just for a very short, little bit, and we're gonna get to work, and we're gonna see some miracles transpire today, amen? Amen. Heavenly Father, we love you. Lord Jesus, we are so incredibly grateful for you, for the work that you're doing in our hearts, the work that you're doing in this house, Father, that we get to sit and watch close to 100 people be baptized this day, Lord, because of your accomplished work in their heart. That, Father, when many of them weren't even looking for you, you came looking for them and you saved their soul. I stand on this stage as a testimony to that. This room is filled with testimonies of that. And so, Lord, I pray that over the course of our next few moments together, you would stir our hearts with a greater affection for Jesus, and that we would leave here today, Father, more in love with you, more inspired to be a bright light into a lost and dying world. We need you desperately, Lord, and we pray this in the matchless name of Jesus. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. While I was at this funeral, it was truly a celebration of life from a man that has meant so much to me, so impactful in my life, has spoken prophetic words over me, saw what I did not see myself, and was instrumental. Actually, this man was the pastor that married my mother and father, and I got to be the beneficiaries of his close proximity to our family. And during the memorial, the celebration, there was a picture that stayed on the background screen for the entirety of the service, and it was him while he was praying at the western end, or known as the Wailing Wall in Jerusalem. And what I found is that his son gave a testimony that he stood for hours at that wall because he was such a prayer warrior. And I remembered, as I looked at that image on the screen, of when I was in Israel and I stood at that wall and I prayed. What's significant about that space and that place is that that Wailing Wall is the closest proximity, why people go there, to the tune of 13,000 Jewish people a day visit that wall and pray there, leaving little papers in between the clefts within the rock and offer up intercession. And the reason is because that is the closest proximity to one of the most iconic structures ever built in Jewish history. That structure would have been Solomon's Temple. And Solomon's Temple was altogether something ground-shaking to the Jewish people, most certainly. And it was so incredible and so iconic, not just because of its sheer size and magnitude, neither was it important because of its design and the intricacies that went into the detail, but moreover, what made that temple so iconic was its purpose. And before I note its purpose, I just want to remind us, those of us that sit within the room, have surrendered our lives to Jesus, that walk with him, that would claim that we are one of his disciples. One of the things that I feel that we so often take for granted is the fact that we have such free access to him. Like every once in a while, we should just literally pinch ourselves, be reminded of, I can't believe that I get to walk with God and know God and hear from God. That I get to hear his still small voice lead me and guide me. I get to have his presence comfort me. That there's no barrier to that access. I can freely come and freely go. When I wake in the morning, he is with me. When I sleep and slumber at night, he is with me. That he promises, I will never leave you and I will never forsake you. That I can talk to him and I can hear from him. I can have my sins forgiven from him and I can be led by him. It's absolutely incredible. It's incredible. It's incredible that we can sit in this space, in this place, and we can sing songs and we can feel his presence and we can hear him convict us and or comfort us. It's incredible. Why? Because it wasn't always like that. Actually, when you consider the Jews in the Old Testament, the nation of Israel, those that followed Yahweh, actually, truth be told, they could go their entire lives, many of them, and never experience the presence of God. Never, never. They just had to believe by faith the stories and the narratives and the tales of patriarchs of old and then believe in it and lead their lives and orient themselves around it. But they could go their whole lives and never experience his presence. Actually, it was only every once in a while that God would show up in the most miraculous fashion, that you would know God is with us. It would happen by way of either a burning bush in the middle of the desert, and he would speak to his prophet and priest Moses, or it would take place by him descending fire on Mount Carmel. It would also take place amidst the Exodus, where they would follow this cloud by day and this fire by night. And then God would speak his oracle through some of his prophets, and they would know that's the word of the Lord. But outside of that, they never knew where is God and when will he show up. They could go their whole lives and never experience the presence that you and I have such free access to. And then all of a sudden, something absolutely ground shaking takes place. That God speaks to a man that he called the apple of his eye, a man by the name of David, the greatest king that would ever rule over Israel. Even to present day, the Jews regard him as such. And God came to David and said, I want you to build me a house. And I want you to build me a house. And actually, I just want you to do the fundraising for it and begin to sort of capture all the materials needed for it. But you can't build it, David. Why? Because you got too much blood on your hands. But your son, the one that will succeed you, he will be the one to build it, Solomon. And he didn't even know the purpose of it. Actually, God just told him, I want you to build me a structure and I'm gonna give you the most specific details and I'm gonna tell you all the materials I want in it. I'm even gonna give you the specificity all the way down to the threads that I want woven in and among the curtains. And I'm gonna tell you what jewels to put in it and I'm gonna tell you how to adorn it. But they still did not know the purpose of it. And so Solomon builds the most iconic building in the history of the Jewish nation. And then the night of the dedication of said temple, God reveals to him why he wanted it built. It says this in 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 15. It says that God now said, now my eyes will be open and my ears attentive to the prayers offered in this place. I have chosen and consecrated this temple so that my name may be there forever. My eyes, God said, and my heart will always be there. Essentially, what God said is, I want you to build me a house so that my presence can dwell in and among my people. It was the first time that God actually allowed heaven to connect with earth permanently. It was the first time in the history of the Jews that would wonder when God would show up, wonder what it was like to be in his presence, wonder how to have access to him, that lived by and large with this holy fear of his preeminence and his majesty, but never would see him. Now all of a sudden, God tells David and Solomon, I want a permanent dwelling place, that there will be a physical structure of where heaven will come down and I will connect with earth. You're probably wondering, well, what's the big deal about the temple? Because truth be told, that temple, it was erected and torn down, erected again, and then torn down. But actually, the temple is no longer, but the principle of the temple still remains. Because though there is not a permanent structure, there's a new temple. This is absolutely incredible. That now, no longer does God just dwell in a single structure. It says this in Corinthians, for now we are the temple of the living God. We, what? You and me are the temple of where God connects heaven to earth as a permanent dwelling place. Just let that percolate for a moment. Because had you told this to the Jews of old, and our forefathers and patriarchs, they would have said, you are cray cray. Only in Glen Burnie would they come up with something like that. People would have never bought it. But now, God dwells in and among the hearts of his people. And when you think about that, Hebrews actually says that now we have a better covenant and now we have better promises. When you think about it, truth be told, there's three things I just wanna give you rapid fire about what makes us being the temple so much better from the temples of old. That number one, let me give it to you like this. Number one, there's no longer one temple. Like actually Jews would pilgrimage. They would spend a lion's share of their years going back and forth to this temple. That it was like their Mecca, if you will. Why? Because the presence of God dwelt there. But now there's not just one temple, there's millions of temples. There's millions of temples that actually you don't have to go to it. We get to go to the world. We get to be the light in and among the darkness. We get to carry the presence of God in and out of our workspaces, in and out of our families, in and out of our homes, in and out of our churches. That actually the presence of God is not restricted to 6691 Bay Meadow Drive. The presence of God goes where you go. Number two, actually, the temple, Solomon's temple, Ezekiel's temple, that temple was a fixed structure. Now, all of these temples, you got these things called legs. Like we're movable, like we can go, that we take the presence of God, that we actually walk in and out of spaces and places as ministers of reconciliation, Corinthians says, as conduits of love. That God calls us not to be static or to stay, but to go. And then lastly, the temple had a fixed structure. It had the God's detail. It was supposed to be adorned in a certain way. Now the temple comes in all various shapes and sizes, backgrounds and stories, eclectic and boring, all kinds of various ways the temple is now. Look at this room. This room is chock full of temples of the living God. We are the temple of the living God, amen? We. And what I wanna say to those that are getting baptized today, that you guys are the temple of the living God, that God found you and he called you and he summoned you and he forgave you and he redeemed you. And now he puts a purpose ahead of you, that you are the temple of the living God, part of the kingdom of God and the family of God. And here's what I just wanna say just for a moment, that when you think of this idea that God came up with, this miraculous sort of miracle that God sort of initiated his church to walk in, that the reality is the temple is no longer, the principle is, but what was true of the temple back then has to be true of the temple today. That if God had a purpose for the temple back then, he most certainly has a purpose for the temples of today. And I just want to give you two things. The first is that the temple was built to be visible. The temple was so visible. So when you consider the Psalms, so many of the Psalms written in scripture, they were called Psalms of Ascent, of where the Jews, as they were going, you always went up to Jerusalem. Why? Because Jerusalem sits on a hill. And so even when I was in Israel years ago, when we were driving up to, we were all in this bus and we were driving up to, there was a lot of Jews that were on this bus and they began to sing the Psalms. They were called Psalms of Ascent. And they would sing these Psalms, Psalm 42 and Psalm 119 and Psalm 19 and on and on and on. They would sing these Psalms as we went up. And the very first thing that you saw when you crest this hill is you saw the temple or the remaining of it. The temple was massive. The remnants of the temple are still seen to this day. It was 20 stories high, made of the most choice rock that were cut from quarries. It was long. I mean, it was like you couldn't miss it. You could see it from miles away. The temple was built to be visible. Why? Because the glory of the Lord filled that temple. And now in the same way, just a little FYI, God calls his temples to be visible. That's why Jesus says in Matthew 5, you guys are the light of the world. Come on, somebody. A city that is set on a hill that cannot be hidden, nor do they light a lamp and they put it under a basket, but they put it on a lampstand and gives light to all who are in the house. Let your light shine before men, that they may see your good work and glorify your Father in heaven. Just so you know, when you go into this watery grave and you come out of it today, do know your porch light goes on. I mean, you are lit up. Today is the day where you are making your first visibility of where you're saying, yeah, I'm with Team Jesus. And yeah, he saved my wretched soul. And yeah, he forgave me of my past. And yeah, he put his name on me. And yeah, my name's written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And yeah, I'm following him. Today, your porch light goes on. But don't let it just be here. Don't let it don't leave your porch light on like in the house of the Lord. And then when you get to Walmart, you're like, all right, I'm gonna set that, I'm gonna turn that sucker off and I'm gonna go crazy. Don't do it. Don't do it. God has called us to be a city on a hill, conduits of love that shine by good works so that men and women may glorify our Father in heaven. I understand that in this present day, there's this idea like, oh, my relationship with Jesus is my private matter. Nobody needs to know about it. That's a farce. God did not call us to be submarine Christians, where we just dip beneath the waterline and every once in a while we'll pop up, like on Sunday, boop, okay. We go into the house of the Lord, you know? But on Monday, go back underwater, nobody knows. You just sort of live like in stealth mode. No. Let your light shine before men and testify of how good Jesus has been to you. I am so proud of you for you stepping out in faith. I know, I grabbed my man over here. I said, are you nervous? He was like, yeah. I get it. I totally get it. But it's in that place that God meets us and sets us on fire. I am so proud of the faith that you're demonstrating today, amen? You are visible today. But then lastly, told you I was gonna be short, but then lastly, not only was the temple to be visible, but the temple was a house of prayer. That the temple was the place that the high priest would go into and offer incense and sacrifice, that he would intercede on behalf of people, and God would listen to their heart's cry and move on their behalf. Understand something. God is not drawn to our perfection. God is drawn to our prayers. That the scripture says that he inclines his ear to our heart's cry, and he listens intently to what we have to say. That you now being a temple of the living God, that your prayer life is of the utmost importance, and that God wants to hear the prayers come from his temple. It says this, that Jesus said in Luke 19, my house, my temple, should be a house of prayer. That this is how we commune with God, and this is how we connect with heaven. And if you are the connection point from heaven to earth, then God wants to lead you and direct you and guide you. So don't stop talking to him. There is something altogether miraculous that takes place when we make it our aim to speak to our Heavenly Father that so longs to hear from his children. That you are called to be visible, and you are called to be a house of prayer. This church, over the last several months, we have made it our aim to cultivate a deeper prayer culture. That we want to be a people, all the more in 20 and 23. I don't know if you've been out there, you turned the TV on lately, but we are going mad by the minute. It is crazy. And if you think that you're going to get through by sheer brute force and strength, oh friend, you're so misguided. How we get through is by the strength of the Holy Spirit that sustains us and keeps us, and by keeping clean ears to hear his still small voice while talking to him about our heart's cry. That we are called to be a house of prayer and at the same time visible. You guys sitting on this front row, you are miracles. That God saw you, found you, saved you. And now today, you're going to testify of that before a church that so deeply loves you. And so Heavenly Father, today, we thank you, we thank you, we thank you that we get to be your temple. That Father, your spirit dwells within us. And Father, you want us to be visible and you want us to be communal. That Father, you've called us to testify of your activity in our life. That men and women would see our good deeds and ultimately glorify you. I pray for my brothers and sisters that are going to get in this watery grave. Lord, perform miracles this moment. Do what only you can do, and we will sing your praises. In Jesus' name, amen.
need a shepherd boy, courageous. I may not face Goliath, but I've got my own giants. Oh God, my God, I need you. Oh God, my children, and you hear your children now. You are the same God. You are the same God. You answered prayers back then, and you will answer now. You are the same God. You are the same God. You were providing when you are providing. You are the same God. You move in power, and God move in power now. You are the same God. You are the same God. You were a healer, and you are a healer now. You are the same. Free in hearts right now. You are the same God. You are the same God. You touch the lepers and I feel your touch right now. You are the same God. You are the same God.
This may be a song that the captives can't yet sing, but if we sing long enough, it might join in with us. This may be a dance that's too heavy for those chains, but if we dance long enough, well, the prisons will open up. Hey! This may be a shout that those fragile lungs can't bear, but if we shout long enough, oh, the walls might finally fall. They may need some help to lift their hands up in the air, but we know that freedom's coming, so we'll sing it all the more. We'll sing, oh, oh, oh. The redeemed now have a song. We'll sing it all day long till the rest come running home. Oh, oh, oh. All the broken, can't you hear? We'll shout it out forever. Can't wait till you make it here. Send those orphans home. We've been waiting all day long. Oh, a ring and a robe is ready just to see them coming now. Just like the prodigal, we're gonna meet them in the road. We'll sing, oh, the redeemed now have a song. We'll sing it all day long till the rest come running home. Oh, 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 all the broken, can't you hear? We'll shout it out forever. Can't wait to. There's no room for you to stay, yeah. Mountains out of the break, at the sound of our voices, at the sound of our prayer.
I don't know about you, but I don't know how you don't get emotional watching 35, 40 people declare a miracle in front of 1,000 people, right? I consider myself a pretty tough guy, but I never get through one of these without tears. So I don't know how anybody does, but what an amazing experience, is it not, to be able to witness that, to be able to witness the public declaration of lives saved by Jesus. And so we're so excited for them. I'd invite you all to just hang out for a second. We're gonna give them a chance to head on out and get a head start on getting changed and everything. So can you celebrate them as they exit? Quite done here yet. We still got a little celebrating to do. So we're gonna hop into another song. We're gonna sing about how Jesus brings us back to life. So would you continue to worship with us as we do that?
So much. Hey, if you need prayer for anything, there's a prayer team up front. But other than that, have a great weekend. Love you.
Amen. How incredible was that to see so many people today publicly take that step to share this picture of what Jesus has done in their life, that salvation work. And so, man, through baptism to see that, and then even through those cardboard testimonies to see individually so many different stories of who they were before Jesus, who they are now because of Jesus. And so that is so encouraging to me. I hope that's been the same for you, as I've seen it's certainly the case for so many is watching these comments roll in. And right now, I just want to say, man, maybe you find yourself, you are a follower of Jesus, but you haven't been baptized. If you're ready to take that step, to learn more about that step, to take that step to be baptized, we want to talk to you. We'd love to baptize you. And everything you need to know is at lh.church/baptism. So if we can be of help with that, if we can baptize you, we'd love to walk alongside you to do exactly that. And again, lh.church/baptism is where to go for that next step. But as we close out, as we like to do at the end of every service, I just want to take a moment here to pray. Specifically for all the needs that would be represented as we're all coming together to do church online. I've seen a couple prayer requests in the comments. And so as we pray in a moment, we certainly want to include Lisa in our prayer, who was in the hospital last week and was diagnosed with irregular heartbeat. And so we want to include you in our prayer here, Lisa. Trisha mentioned that she's in Mercy Hospital right now. We don't know all the details there, but certainly want to include that in our prayer as well. And so for those requests, as well as any others that would be present, maybe you're watching on demand, maybe there's something in the comments I didn't get a chance to read off, or perhaps it's just an unspoken request. As we're all coming together, I just want to lift up all these needs, all these requests, and invite you right now to pray with us as we do exactly that. And so let's pray. Lord, we thank you for this chance to come together. We thank you for all these baptisms that we just saw, for each of those people, their own story of what you've done in their lives. Lord, thank you for this step that they took today to publicly share this picture of the salvation work that you've done in their lives, Lord. And I just want to pray for that person right now that maybe they're on the fence, that person who believes in you, Lord, who is following you but hasn't taken the step of baptism, and maybe they're just on the fence right now. Whatever would be holding them back, Lord, I just pray that you would do a work within their heart. Give them the confidence, the conviction, Lord, to take that step. Lord, if there's any questions, just help them to work through that, Lord. But I just pray that you would just do something within anyone who finds themselves right now on the fence but perhaps ready to take that step of baptism. And when it comes to those requests that I just read off, I just pray, Lord, that you'd be with these people, you'd be with these different health concerns, and ultimately for health and healing, for wisdom for the doctors involved in the medical care in these different situations right now, Lord. Ultimately, just for peace and comfort, even in the midst of hospital visits and treatment and what have you, Lord. And in so many different circumstances and situations, as we just lift up all these different needs and requests to you, Lord, we just ask in all of these circumstances and all of these situations that you would move, that you would help in a way that only you could. We seek you and ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. As always, thank you so much for joining us. We cannot wait to see you again soon.